All right, this is Gerrit Leonhard, futurist in Switzerland. And I'm meeting today here, virtually meeting, with Rohit Bhargava, who I've been following for years. And he used to be with Ogilvy. We'll talk about that in a second. He wrote a smashing book that I've quoted the book even before it was out, with a really great title called Likeonomics, the economics of what it means to be liked and how you're going to get liked as a company, as a person. So we're going to talk about that today for a couple of minutes. And Rohit will also be helping us do some work with the Futures Agency and stuff in the future. So welcome, Rohit. And please explain to us real quick, what is Likeonomics?
Of course, Likeonomics is a pretty simple idea. It essentially says that we choose to do business and build relationships with the people that we like. And in a situation when we are making decisions every day about who to work with and who to trust, likability becomes the most important thing. And that's the premise of the book, and that's really what a lot of the research and everything is focused on pointing out.
Yeah, I mean, I've used the term Likeonomics when you first emailed me or somehow we connected. I used the term. And a lot of my clients said, you know, what in the world? Like, and it sounds like California pipe dream, you know, that you would lag your bank or something like that.
Yeah.
And you know, now when I talk about it and I use some of the graphics in my presentations, you know, then the client is saying, you know, this is, you know, why we don't want people to like us. We want them to buy our stuff.
Yeah.
So how does one relate to the other?
Yeah, I think a lot of people do kind of dismiss likability, and it's easy to do because, you know, people equate it with being nice, and they say, look, I don't want to be too nice. I want to actually be a hard business person, and I want to sell real stuff. And I think what people underestimate a lot is how important that emotional side is to the decision-making. And I think there's a lot of material out there talking about how people in general are emotional decision-makers, but I think that when it comes to the big companies and the banks especially, there's this bias towards the product or the service mm-hmm. or the idea, in a lot of cases, being the thing that people buy. If I just had a better idea, if I just had a better product, if I just deliver better service, then everybody's going to come to me. And I think the world doesn't work like that, and the reason why it doesn't work like that is because that alone is never enough, because there's always somebody else around the corner who has a different product that's slightly better in a different way,
mm-hmm.
or somebody who's willing to do something else to provide service that you might not be. And so you have to stand out and build loyalty based on something other than just trying to have the best list of bullet points, because that's not sustainable for
yeah,
any of these.
It's an interesting angle. You know, you have people like Rachel Boltzmann talking about collaborative consumption and social capital and those kind of things, right? Now, I think in America, this idea, this concept of being open to more sort of the soft factors of business or of commerce is quite popular. In Europe and Asia, this idea is pretty far-fetched that a company would
yeah.
have social capital. You know, can you imagine,
yeah.
you know, Lufthansa having social capital or, you know, for enough reason for people to buy their stuff. But I think this is becoming a crucial thing of what Kleiner Perkins has called the social local mobile world, you know, the Solomo idea
yeah.
Of saying
yeah.
that, you know, social capital is the driving force there. Right? And in your book,
yeah,
you mentioned this several times.
Yeah, I think social capital is the reason why it's such a driving factor is because it relates back to something that marketers and business people everywhere in the world all say is one of, if not the most important thing, but they don't actually behave as if it were. And that thing is word of mouth. So everybody in the world knows that referral-based marketing, somebody saying to someone else, this is a great product, you have to buy it. There's nothing more powerful than that. Nothing. And that's a universal quality. It's not like a
yep.
U.S. thing.
Yep.
It's everywhere. But if you look at the behavior of a lot of these marketing and communications people, they don't actually do all of what they could do to make that word of mouth happen. And so there's this disconnection in business, I think. And part of it does come down to understanding how people make decisions and why emotions matter.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's also this idea that from a social capital point of view, yes, we want a great product, but it also, when we buy that product, it says something about us. And is it something positive or is it something negative? And is it something we'd want to share with the world? And if it were, then we'd proudly wear that brand on our sleeve. We'd wear the Adidas thing because we associate with that. And we say, that's my brand.
Yeah, I think that is something that because of the mobile internet and the social internet is becoming centerpiece now of everything. Like, you know, which school do you attend? Not because it's the best professors or so, but for some reason the brand is important. Which music do you listen to?
Yeah.
You know, ECM Records has a brand, and even though people don't buy records anymore, they do buy ECM records, you know, and things like that. So it's crucial.
And it starts at, I mean, we are training our next generation for this as well. I mean, my 8-year-old right now wants Under Armour. That's what he loves. And it's because he likes that logo and because all of his friends and the other kids are wearing it. And so, like, at a very young age, we're seeing this brand level of consciousness saying, yes, I like this brand, and no, I don't like that brand. And, you know, ultimately, I mean, we talk about branding a lot, but branding is the value of branding is very simple. It's you can charge more for the exact same thing.
Is this kind of, you know,
better brand, you can charge more.
There's a related topic that I run into a lot when I speak about Lyconomics, is that I tell people basically what is happening is that because of this, we're looking at the end of lying, you know, this idea that you could sell something that wasn't entirely so, or something that wasn't actually like you said it would be, which isn't exactly lying, it's like whitewashing, you know, but everybody has done that in the past, right? And now all of a sudden, because of Lyconomics, you can't lie anymore.
Well, I think that, you know, the way I would position it is it's the end of viral lying. Okay. And viral lying is when you'd had advertising that said the movie was great, and it would be a good week before people found out that it actually isn't great. But by then, you'd kind of made your money back. And now, I mean, that was viral lying because it lasted for a while. Yeah. And now you put the movie out, and on Thursday night before it, you know, when it premieres, everybody tweets about it and says, do not go and see that. And opening weekend, nothing happens. You crash. You can't count on that anymore. And so I think that this idea that you can keep some sort of perception that you've built and people won't really find out the truth, that doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, I think that's, I mean, this is one reason why people should read your book, right? Clearly, and it's interesting, you know, my last book called The Future of Content talks about how media companies are changing and how media is changing, how the buying of media is changing. And I used this word in there already. This is 3 years old or so, but it's on Amazon if you want to get it. But it's basically talking about how being liked as an author is becoming the most important thing because you build a network of connections that becomes viral using viral networks. And it's interesting also to see that social networks are, in a way, becoming broadcasters because they broadcast the like, right? And and that is the same than having an ad on TV now.
Right? Yeah, I think that, you know, one of the central premises of the book is this idea of what I call the likability gap. Mm-hmm. And essentially what that points to is this idea that customer satisfaction in some way isn't enough. Because a satisfied customer, if you think about a restaurant, a satisfied customer goes to the restaurant, they have a good meal, they're full, the service is good, they leave, and they forget about it. That's a satisfied customer.
Yeah.
The problem is that's not enough. You need the customer who has such an amazing meal, that has a great conversation with the chef or with the owner or with the waiter, that then goes home, writes a review online, tells 25 people that they have to go and try that restaurant, and comes back 5 times. That's the customer you need.
Yeah.
And the only way you can get that person is by doing something other than just having a good product.
Yeah, I think that this is, of course, in each vertical is completely different. Like, you know, in Italy, for example, where I used to go a lot on vacation, or even in Spain, a lot of people don't write reviews because they don't want to share that it was good, right? Because it's sort of theirs, right? This would be one thing, but with cars, for example, or with consumer brands or electronics or so, this is clearly a huge driver because it's, you know, and it's also a cultural difference, a very big cultural difference as to who talks about what they've done and who doesn't, right? And this is,
yeah, I think
this
also
is still quite different.
There's this idea of, I think you're right, you're bringing up something very interesting, which is this idea, it really goes back to social capital. If you think about that Italian example, you know, that person may know about that amazing restaurant, but they're not going to share it with everybody. But they will share it with some people, very specific people, because that's their social capital.
Yeah.
That's their restaurant they know about, the experience that they know about, that they'll tell a very, very few people about, but they'll be very passionate about it when they do.
Yeah, this is why I like the title Lyconomics, you know, because it really, there's an economic principle behind it that has always existed, right? But now, because of the social and mobile web, it's amplified, right? So I think this is something that everybody should look at also in regards to their business model. I just saw this really great video the other day from Kraft Foods about how they had an a cappella band giving a thank you to all the people that have liked them. You know, it's and it shows, you know, how important this is becoming for branding. It becomes a lot more important than having an ad on television. I mean, not quite yet, but close.
Yeah, I think, you know, that level of engagement, and I mean, in humanity, right? And that's the big thing that we're all talking about, is how do brands show more humanity to build that personal connection? I mean, there was an orchestra in Calgary in Canada that asked people on Twitter, because Calgary is quite a cold place, so they asked people tips to stay warm. And then the orchestra and the chorus sang those tweets and recorded it. Yeah, so this is the level of engagement. I mean, you know, even an orchestra singing tweets, right? Yeah. This is happening all over the place.
I think this is one of the big things that's happening in the general world of advertising and marketing, is that there's so much talk about algorithms and big data, and, you know, people becoming subject to filters and cloud and peer index, you know, this machine thinking, right, basically, that I think it's so important not to have this machine thinking, because if brands are machines, then we can't relate to them, right?
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think, I mean, one of the big trends that I think is happening right now, and one that I'm starting to write about, is this idea that the brands that are able to have that human connection on an extreme level, not only are they being super successful, but they're turning their own model into a consulting service to help other brands. Yeah. So you see Method doing that, you see Disney doing that, you see Zappos doing that, all over the place. These companies, Innocent Drinks is doing that. All of these companies that have done this amazing job of building human brands are now saying, hey, why don't we take those lessons and teach other businesses how to do that?
Yeah, this goes back to what we discussed earlier. You know, there are very few secrets left. I mean, if you watch what Innocent does with their, or what Nike Women does with the Women channel, you know, these are completely out in the open, and you can copy it, right? I mean, you can use their approach, and it's visible, right? That's completely different than 10 years ago, where it wasn't clear what your marketing strategy was. Right? So anyway, tell people where they can get your book and what your Twitter handle is and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. So you can get the book at anywhere online, Amazon or any of the online bookstores, or you can download a free excerpt at likeonomics.com. So it's just like and then onomics.
Okay.
And my Twitter handle is just my first name, and that's also my personal website. So it's Rohit Bhargava. I know it's a little hard to spell, but I'm sure you'll have my name on there somewhere. So
just Google for Likeonomics, you'll see it, right? And I'm
just follow Likeonomics, and or just Google that, or just Google my first name, Rohit, R-O-H-I-T, and you should be able to find it too.
Okay, great. So it was a pleasure to have you here, and thanks everyone for tuning in. Hopefully this is good enough to actually publish, but we'll see you down the road. Thanks very much.
All right, thank you.